So let's get started with an introduction to algorithms. First of all, we should look at a definition. What is an algorithm? Well, the Merriam-Webster dictionary says it is a procedure for solving a mathematical problem in a finite number of steps. Of course, I don't read all the quotes every time. So what is important here is that it's a procedure solving a problem in a finite number of steps. Okay? And we will define this further in the next couple of slides, what it means, and have some examples. Good. Broadly speaking, it is a step-by-step procedure for solving a problem or accomplishing some end. All right? Yeah, that looks a bit more tied down to your understanding, but still we need to really look into a proper definition that we will use in the lecture instead of some dry material that comes from the dictionary. Okay, let me cite here one quote from Donald Knuth. Algorithms are the threads that tie together most of the subfields of computer science. So I found it really motivating, and it basically says that algorithms are a key to understand the topics of computer science. So it's not just one field of computer science that deals with algorithms, but basically all the fields of computer science. So that means it's really elementary for you to understand, and that's why you should pay close attention to today's lecture. Good. So our definition of algorithms is: an algorithm is a sequence of unambiguous executable steps defining a terminating process for solving a problem. So how does this look? So first of all, we have to define the problem. The problem is defined by information relevant to the problem, and we encode this typically as some kind of input data. Then this is fed into the algorithm. The algorithm does some kind of executable steps, performs executable steps on this input data. Okay, and then it will generate our solution, which is represented as output data. Okay, so input data and output data is typically well defined according to the purpose of the algorithm. Okay, so an algorithm has three key properties that are defined in this sentence already: definiteness, effectiveness, and finiteness. Definiteness means each of the steps that you do must be precisely defined. So that means they must be unambiguously specified for all the possible cases that you have on this input data or on intermediate data, such that it can be executed. Second, effectiveness. So all the operations, they must be sufficiently basic that they can be done exactly, that means with 100% accuracy, and also in a finite time. Finally, finiteness. The algorithm must have an end. So it must produce some kind of output, because otherwise it's worthless, because you never get a solution. Okay? So now, looking into those three properties, definiteness, effectiveness, and finiteness, and into input data and output data in this little diagram here, I ask you to think about if you can give an example for an algorithm. Maybe you have executed an algorithm. If so, what algorithm? And if you did, what kind of input and output did you feed in? Think about it for a minute, and I will, in this video's series, I will do it as follows, that I will just pause the video. Well, not I will pause the video. Well, I will continue to talk, but you should pause the video, okay? And I will just proceed further. So, now that you have paused the video and thought about this issue, here are a couple of example algorithms. In a nutshell, I am 100% sure that you have applied algorithms because they are everywhere in our daily lives. For instance, when you follow recipes, when you cook, when you make a cake, you follow those instructions, and those instructions are well defined by defining what input you take, which is the material you feed in, into. Then you run this algorithm, which is kind of the recipe, how to work through these different materials. And finally, the output is typically something like a meal or a nice cake that you can eat. Well, there are other activities like showering, coffee making and driving a car that you could see they are algorithms in fact. And we will talk about this. Next, when you think about machines, of course, every day what you're using is your smartphone. And in your smartphone, you have biometric identification by fingerprint or by face recognition. Well, that is an algorithm, albeit a more complicated one. Also, when you just push a button of an elevator, well, something happens in the back. This is just an algorithm that makes a decision to move the elevator up and down. So this is a very primitive algorithm, but it's nevertheless an algorithm. So algorithms originated from Mars, where you can find a lot of examples, from very simple ones to highly complicated ones. But let's start with a couple of simple ones. So if I give you two integer values, how do you identify the bigger one? Well, how can you find all prime numbers in an interval from 1 to another number, let's say from 1 to 100? How can you do that? How do you compute the circumference of a circle? So, additional properties of algorithms are listed here. First of all, they should be machine independent. That means the outcome that you produce is the same regardless for whatever hardware you run this algorithm. Or how the algorithm has been formulated. So you can formulate the same algorithm using different programming languages and it always will produce the same output. So what does this mean, right? That means this abstract figure here, it remains the same. So if I give you the same input, for example, for our computer circumference, right? If I say the circumference of a circle that has a radius of 1, well, you run the algorithm, it produces the output. Right? The output should always be the same when you use with the same circumference. If you do the math manually, right? If you compute it on a sheet of paper, or if you compute it using a calculator in your PC or what have you, right? It's always the same outcome. Taking our real life example, well, if I give you a recipe how to bake bread, right? I give it to you and I give it to your colleague here, well, and I give you all the same, input, which are the different materials needed, then you should both get at the end delicious bread, if you follow the algorithm correctly, right? So two different hardware, still the same output, using the same algorithm. Okay, so that's what machine independence means. Next, correctness. So this is implicitly assumed normally, right? So an algorithm is supposed to always return the desired output for all possible legal instances of the problem. We always assume this, right? If I tell you compute pi for a radius of 100 and you say the number is 2, which is obviously wrong, well, the algorithm is broken, okay? It should not happen. So there are ways to formally verify that algorithms work correctly, and there's also a way to test this. So you will learn about this in this lecture, but also in software engineering. So you, by testing your software, you try to make sure that the algorithm produce the right output, but you can never be 100% sure. You just try to sort of increase the confidence that the algorithm is correct by testing a couple of things, right? For example, I could say, well, bake a bread for 2 people, okay? So the algorithm produces bread for 2 people, or you bake a bread for 2 people. Produce a bread for 4 people, right? And the algorithm should produce a bread for 4 people. And if both work, hopefully you can produce also bread for 3 people, right? So that's kind of one of the ideas of testing. So finally, an algorithm should be efficient, and it can be measured in terms of various resources. One is runtime, so how long does the algorithm take? We talk in computer science about time complexity. Secondly, it's about the memory requirement, which is space complexity. And lastly, it's about communication. How much data do you need to communicate? But for now, only really the runtime, which is the time complexity, will be relevant as part of this lecture.